So, Anthony, I'm going to start today's episode with a little story.
I love stories.
So back in World War II, scientists were using sonar to map the bottom of the ocean floor. So they were sending this high-frequency sound down into the deep and then measuring how long it would take to come back up. But something really odd was happening. They were noticing that the bottom of the sea was moving. At night, the ocean floor was really shallow.
I'm intrigued.
And then in the daytime, it would go down to hundreds of meters deep.
It's raising and lowering by hundreds of meters. That's not how sonar is supposed to work.
Every day. And they were like, what is going on? But it wasn't until a few years later that they finally figured it out. There is an area of the ocean called the deep scattering layer that is so full of animal life that it was creating a false bottom signal.
Like a blanket of wildlife.
Just like a blanket
that
of wildlife.
That is incredible.
Isn't that mind-blowing?
That's amazing. Like, hard to imagine.
It's hard to imagine. Where these animals live is in an area of ocean called the Twilight Zone. So that's between 200 and 1,000 meters. It is dark, it is cold, and the pressure, that's the big one. We would not be able to withstand that high of the pressure. And that is a big reason why this area of the world has remained largely unexplored. It's inaccessible. So, despite all those setbacks, there is one creature that lives there that I think will totally blow your mind.
Okay.
The anglerfish. So, Anthony, have you seen this viral video of the anglerfish in the shallow waters?
I haven't seen it yet, no.
It's the first time that people have seen a deep-sea fish in real time. They've been able to video it in shallow waters because they never come up. What I love is that it is having a viral moment. So I would love to talk to you about the anglerfish. This is the Croyer's deep-sea anglerfish. What do you notice about this fish?
I'm seeing some very tendril-like tail fins. I'm used to seeing those fins that they use to kind of change direction on the side, but I don't really see any there.
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right. So you're talking about the tail fin. This is a more familiar fish, right? Like, this is a salmon. It has that familiar tail that you're talking about.
Right, yeah.
And it has a dorsal fin and also pectoral fins.
Yep.
So the pectoral fins here are basically invisible. They have been completely reduced as to be almost useless.
Right.
They think the reason for this is because down in the water column, these animals are not swimming very much. They're kind of moving with the current. They have such a low metabolism, they have to conserve their energy. And so that's probably why their pectoral fins are almost negligible. They're not doing very much work.
Right. So if they're not moving, how are they getting their food?
So this thing on its head is like a fishing rod, essentially.
Right.
And it actually comes from their dorsal spine. Their first dorsal spine on a dorsal fin that is now gone has migrated over time all the way to here and has gotten really long. And then on the end is what they call an esca, which in Latin means bait. So this little organ on the end is a photophore, meaning that it lights up.
Right. Wow, you came prepared.
So you're so deep in the ocean. There is zero light coming down from the sunlight. You have to figure out really creative ways to make your own light. And how they do this is through bacteria. Bacteria is floating around in the Twilight Zone. There's a lot of bacteria in this place. And they find their way into that esca through a pore opening. And they have got a symbiotic relationship whereby the bacteria will luminesce, it will light up on command.
What?
And the bacteria in turn will gain a comfy home, it'll be protected, it'll get nutrients, and this fish now has bait for life.
I can't believe this. So there's bacteria in there are not part of the fish.
No.
So this is like the coolest infection ever. Like if I got an infection like that in my finger, I could be like E.T., like ouch, like light things up under the ocean.
Yeah, yeah.
It would be awesome.
But come on, it really looks like a fishing rod.
That's what I would have thought. Like,
right?
I always thought that they use these things as kind of like a lure.
That's exactly what the theory is. They dangle this fishing rod and their bait in front of their face, and they wait for something
to come. So isn't that going to be a problem for this guy? I mean, sure, he'll be able to use his light, and then that means he can attract prey. But also, predators can see that too. And if I love the taste of these guys, all I got to do is look for the stars floating around down in the water.
Very good point. So what scientists have determined is the color of their skin is so dark that they're basically invisible. So think about it. If you have a regular piece of black paper.
Okay.
This reflects about 10% of light. But some of these deep sea creatures, not this one in particular, but other deep sea fish, they're called ultra black. They reflect 0.04% of light.
Yeah, so they're basically just like a sink for light. They're just absorbing.
They absorb.
They're like a black hole.
They're like a black hole. That's what some scientists have said, they feel like they're staring into a black hole. It's really frustrating. Some of these scientists have taken pictures of these fish,
right,
and you can't see anything. All you can see is an outline. You can't see the eyes, you can't see the fins, because all of the light is absorbed. So it's a very strange experience.
Yeah.
We don't actually know necessarily what this fish looks like in its natural habitat going about its day-to-day life.
Right.
So this is our,
this is our best guess.
So not only are these some of the darkest animals in the animal kingdom, but it's some of the darkest matter that has ever been known, even
fish
synthetically
dark matter.
Created. Yes, and that's one of the ways they are able to camouflage. You have to depend on your camouflage. Otherwise,
right.
predators
your
could
food.
See you or your food could see you. If a little prey comes up, it sees the lure, it's interested, it
right.
doesn't see the big scary face behind it because it's so well camouflaged. This fish will then employ gape and suck feeding, which means they open their mouth really wide and they create a negative space, and that negative pressure acts like a vacuum and it just sucks it all up. Super efficient.
Gape and suck, that's the technical term.
Another neat thing.
We're gonna glaze right past that.
Yes,
yep.
Moving on. So they're not running into food all the time.
Okay.
And if they find food, they're gonna eat it, no matter what it is. Sometimes their food is way bigger than their mouths and they somehow have to get it sucked in and then their stomachs will expand to accommodate it.
Right, you're in the middle of space. Like if a sandwich hits you when you're in the middle of space, I don't care if it's too big, you eat that hoagie.
You're gonna open your mouth, exactly.
Yeah.
I couldn't help but notice you kept referring to this fish as a he.
Yeah, I don't know why.
Isn't that gonna be a problem for this guy? He'll be able to use his light and then that means he can attract prey.
Turns out it's a she.
Okay.
And we know this because the male looks very different.
Really?
Yes. So let me show you. This is the male. Can you even see that?
It's tiny. It's about the size of your thumb, maybe, like the top part of your thumb. Not even.
This is the male.
Yeah, it's small.
This is the female.
Wait, this is to scale?
This is to scale.
Okay, but like, all right.
Right? This male is 60 times smaller than the female, and by weight, half a million times smaller.
Yeah, that's ridiculous. How does she avoid eating him?
Well, I think what happens is he comes to her, and he comes to her from the behind.
Right.
So what happens is this little male is down in the water column. He has to find his female. Then he has to latch onto her. He turns into a parasite.
Wow.
So I thought it would be pretty cool if we played a game called Pin the Parasitic Male on a Female. What do you think?
I'm down.
I mean, I haven't told you where.
How could I not do this?
Where he latches onto,
I have
given you a hint. He comes at her from behind. Okay.
That's how it happens.
Now,
I gotta
swap him out with a purple version.
Okay.
He's normally black, but also.
I'm blindfolded.
And then also, I'm going to blame this on Steven, the director, but he wants you to spin around and then do it.
I'm down to do this. I'm going to pin A parasitic male onto the lady parts.
There we go.
Of a female anglerfish.
Okay, see, so
in the
got
Twilight
that?
Zone. Says, am I gonna hit okay. lights here?
No, you're good. Right okay. there. Okay, now slowly spin.
I'm gonna rotate.
Yeah, okay, now stop.
Okay.
Okay, now sit down. Wait, don't sit down there. Okay, sit down over here.
Okay.
Okay, and now pin that parasitic male.
Okay, and is it, where's the image? Okay, it's over here. I'm trying to feel if there's like any texture that I can feel. I never thought I'd be feeling up a female anglerfish.
You can't feel anything.
Okay. And there's a sticky part, I don't know if I've...
Yeah, you got it.
Okay.
Nice.
And what I'm aiming for in my mind, what I'm touching right now in my mind's eye is the, just under the fin, where I imagine, like, that's where he's...
Okay, yeah, take off your blindfold. Where, look where you put the parasite.
Okay.
Now, you did not latch on to anything, so this male will die. He doesn't have the jaws to catch prey. He doesn't even have a developed gut. He's gonna die. So he's swimming along. Oh, yay, I found her. I mean, what are the chances, right? And he latches on probably like that.
Okay.
Okay, once he makes contact,
right.
That's it for him. He's not swimming anymore.
This is the rest of his life.
His skin, his vascular system, his blood all fuse and become part of the female
fish. So he becomes the female fish.
Two become one.
Wow, oh my.
Yes. Once he latches on and fuses to her,
yeah.
His organs start to degenerate, his eyes start to degenerate. He basically becomes completely unrecognizable as a fish and he turns into a parasite. So she gains an unlimited source of sperm, which is really important in those deep, dark oceans because you never know if you're gonna find a mate. Now she's got one for life. So in order for this little male to become fused to the female
right.
and to begin sharing a vascular system, she has had to adapt a way to decrease her immune response.
Well, I mean, I guess that makes sense.
Normally, exactly.
Yeah, if something bites you and stays attached to you for the rest of your life, my natural response would be like, get off.
Yeah, exactly. And that would be the response of your body as well, to say, get this off of me.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want this around. But instead, she has to welcome his presence and all of his fluids. It works out great for him because he doesn't have to work anymore. It's a win-win. So this is called obligate sexual parasitism.
You've showed me some weird fish in the past, Sarika. I mean, some weird things. This has to take the cake. This is the weirdest fish I've ever seen.
Weird? Would you really say weird? I mean, I guess...
Yes, I would. You wouldn't say...
Well, it's different, weird. Right? But, like, it's extraordinary. Because
yes.
In order to live in a basically inhospitable area...
Yeah.
It has adapted all sorts of creative ways to survive. I mean, from the light organ on its head, employing that weird method of
yeah.
feeding. Okay, I said weird, sure, I'll give that to you. And then, of course, the reproduction. I mean...
I don't think weird is bad. It's wonderfully weird. It's amazingly weird, but it's definitely weird. Like, this is weird.
It's different, it's different.
May not be beautiful to us, but to this guy, it is in the eye of the beholder.
Life in the Twilight Zone, man. It's crazy.
So crazy. All right, dude, sorry, I'll put you back. Enjoy. You guys, we'll give some private time. We can put the blanket back on and give him some private time.
Our director and producer, he said that anglerfish are actually in Finding Nemo.
I never saw it.
Neither have I, so
okay.
I know.
You guys haven't seen Finding Nemo?
I'm
okay, tonight.
Sorry. No,
we'll watch it tonight.
Yeah.
We trust you, though.